the fixed threads and the thread which is moving. So that is the link in between the steadiness and movement. Movement is energy. Steadiness is this quality of, as I call it, that thing, which is once again consciousness, understanding, understand well. So it is why it has been called Tantra. That's the meaning of it. Now those Tantras, those books, are mainly practical exercises, but they are written in such a way that it's quite difficult to understand that they are exercises. They seem to be only philosophical talks. And one of them has been very much appreciated. It seems to be the oldest one. Scholars think it's about 2,000 years old. It is called the Vijnana Bhairava Tantra. Vijnana, jnana means knowledge. Bhairava means terrible. Forceful, powerful. And Tantra is the book. So it's a dialogue, and the main theme is the power of knowledge. And it gives 112 exercises for trying to find that quality of relationship which will take us into the nature of the process of relationship, which is linking everything together. Everything means really everything. This is why those texts have been looked at sacred. But once again, we have to be careful. They are sacred because they are helping, or they can help us to taste the sacredness of life. That's the only reason. They're not sacred because of the paper or the ink or whatever. There are hundreds of tantras, maybe more than hundreds, maybe thousands, I don't know. But this one is a very, very important one because it's the easiest one to study. The others are, the language which is used in is not easy at all. So we had this idea with Adrian to start a study, to open a kind of study process about this text. Not studying it as we did at school, you know, you try to understand what it is meaning. So we try to understand, but we also try, we don't try. We go into the exercises which are explained. And the idea came because just by chance, 2 years ago, just by chance, I came across Adrian it was in Athena, in Greece. And it was very strange, just met and a friend of us, a woman, introduced us one to the other. And Adrian said, well, I heard you know about Kashmir Shivaism. I said, yes, I've been studying this since long. And at the same time, I received an email from a student who said, look, I found a lecture from your master, which is dead since long. Find it on what was it, YouTube? So I said, look, this is very strange. Just talking about that, and that comes in. So Adrian said, okay, I invite you. You come to Rwanda. So we have done three seminars, and we have decided to start a regular study program that will last, one second long. The idea for the beginning of 3 years, we'll see. So that's one of the reason I am talking to you this evening. And maybe it's enough talking. The very last point is that many of these traditions are more or less disappearing slowly, because the modernity, the life as it is, the speed of life, and many of us, we want to achieve very quickly whatever, and those texts are talking about stopping to achieve. So they are not in the fashion. So those traditions are more or less decaying. I don't know if they will stand for long. Maybe. Optimistic people say they will never die. Pessimistic people say we are at the end. I have no idea. But I know they are slowly disappearing, because there are less and less teachers. Yoga is spreading in such a way that there are many, many books. I was talking about that this weekend here, and the book said, if you do this, you have exercises written in the book, and at the end you'll be written benefits, what you will acquire if you do that. And at the end of the book, you have a list. So if you have headaches, page 132. If you have problem with your stomach, page 236 and all. So you turn and say, well, I have to do this. So it's becoming very, very practical, that the problem is becoming narrow. So the opportunity for, as we say, spreading the teaching is also important for the teaching to go on, for this memory of mankind to go on, not to be forgotten. Because when we are looking at the world today, we can really ask ourselves, what is the next step? Where are we going to be at this? Are we going to survive? What is going to happen? It's very difficult to feel at ease when we're facing the movement of the world. And some of these old teachings are always so much insisting on the fact that our nature is a strong possibility of a complete, a total life living completely. And completely aware also, and happy. The texts are not talking about happiness, they're talking about bliss. They don't say you'll be happy, they say you will live in blissful state. Wow, that's interesting. But it's a big, big question for us today. Is it possible to discover that quality in this world as it is, that quality which has been explained as being natural, of being conscious, being fully alive and happy? So all these teachings, as I've always said, yes, it's possible, and We have quite many testimonies of people who have done that trip, that research. And I'm here again to say that exists, that is possible. Let's give it a try, let's give it a chance. Thank you.
What a nice talk. And of course, I invite you to put some questions because your meditative state in which you are now, because it was such a quiet atmosphere, I believe that we can now start some questions, because we have here not only an important guy that knows what he wants to say, but he offers us, let's say, some lectures, some school. That is not it's a lot of things, but it's something. So, please, if you want to put some questions, please do it now.
It's time to go out of meditation. I would give you different answers because none of them is the right one. traditionally, we have this tendency to say the only reason of life is to live. There's no other reason. Life has no reason. Now, we as human beings, we have this particular tool, which apparently we are the only one having it so sophisticated on this planet, which is the thought. And we try to, we don't try, we're facing whole life with our thought and questioning it. Now, there are many different levels in the thinking process, let's say in the thought. When we put a question, from where do we put the question? Is it mainly, how could we say, intellectual? Or is it a burning question? There can be emotions. Is it a vital question? Vital, that means, am I near to die for the answer? So where is the starting point of question? Now, saying that, I'm trying to stay at the very basic understanding. When we are looking at our life, there are three main activities. This is the very first sight. One activity is what we could call vitality, the intensity we have to live. And sometimes the vitality is high, sometimes it's very low. Sometimes let's say it has a certain intensity that we would say it's average, but it's changing all the time. And this vitality is, we could say, it's like the fuel with which we can manage our daily life, whatever happens. Then there is another domain of our life, which is, with vitality, what goes with vitality are the sensations. The five levels of sense, you know that, huh? The five sense, five types of sensations. These are the processes which are operating upon what we call vitality. Then there is another domain that we call emotion, the emotional domain of our life. So we describe that there are nine different types of emotions. And here again, these emotions, they need the fuel of vitality. They're working, they're operating through the fuel of vitality. And sometimes we are angry, sometimes we are caring and loving, sometimes we are jealous, you know, emotions. Then there is a third domain, which is that we call the mind. And the mind is mainly three different aspects. What we today we call, since Freud, the waking state, sleeping state, dreaming state, conscious, subconscious, and conscious. So, and all these processes are always operating, and they are bringing us a perception